Beautiful Dream Awake, BDW. Brian Douglas Wilson, that's me.
George Gershwin, Cole Porter, Richard Rodgers, Burt Bacharach, Brian Wilson.
When I was a little baby, I used to listen to Rhapsody in Blue. That's when it first started coming into my soul, with Rhapsody in Blue. SMiLE is experimental music, and I was really worried that it wouldn't go over. Like when Gershwin was worried about Rhapsody in Blue in 1924 in Paris.
We heard about SMiLE being made at the time when we were in the 60s, and we were so excited, we were waiting for it, and rumors were it was great, but we never heard anything. And it was coming out, and we were waiting for it, and it never happened. We waited in vain.
Hawthorne, California, a working-class suburb of Los Angeles located just a few minutes from the Pacific Ocean. Hawthorne is a dozen miles and a million light-years away from Hollywood. In 1942, Brian Wilson is the first of three sons born to Murray and Audrey Wilson. Although Brian is deaf in his right ear, his left ear is clearly tuned into something very special.
When I was about 8 years old, my dad taught me how to play boogie-woogie. He taught me that. That's when I first knew I had a gift for music, because I could really like it.
Brian's father recognized his son's gift and made sure that Brian had the opportunity to develop it, filling the Wilson home with music. Unfortunately, the other sounds Brian heard in the house weren't as harmonious.
My dad was a very, very hostile, messed up man with a lot of hatred in him. He would yell at us. If he heard us talking at night, he'd open the door and he'd slam the door open real loud and crash against the wall. "You kids get to sleep or I'll beat the hell out of you." He used to talk to us that way, yeah.
Murray Wilson was a successful businessman, an unsuccessful songwriter, and a dominant presence in the Wilson household.
I was like this. This is what I was like. I had my right hand like this over my soul and my left hand like this, and I would walk around the school like this, afraid of being hit, because my dad would hit me so much. And I never got hit by anybody in the school, never got hit in the face or in the body. But it took me like until my junior year in high school to finally relax and walk like this, walk around like a man.
Brian lived in fear of failure, of disappointing his father, and as a result, he became a tremendous competitor, a varsity athlete at Hawthorne High.
His focus in life was to be successful as a center fielder for the New York Yankees.
Oh, I wanted to, but I couldn't, you know. I wanted to be Mickey Mantle.
And he had an arm that was qualified. He could hit the long ball, but he didn't hit the curveball very well.
I couldn't hit a curveball for beans. I couldn't hit a curveball at all.
Fortunately, Brian didn't need to hit the curve. His growing enthusiasm for music would get him to the big leagues.
When I was about 14 years old, I started listening to rhythm blues shows on the radio, and I had an affinity. I felt a real strong affinity with records like Earth Angel by the Penguins, In the Still of the Night, and Over the Mountain, Rock Around the Clock. I had such an affinity with those records that I knew in my heart that one day I would make music like that. I knew I would. I didn't know when and where or what, but I knew I would.
The Beach Boys were essentially a family band. Brian's brothers, Dennis on drums and Carl on lead guitar. First cousin Mike Love, the lead singer, was Brian's most frequent songwriting partner. High school friend Al Jardine was on rhythm guitar. Brian played bass and sang the soaring, operatic falsettos. As exciting as it was for the boys to make it, being a Beach Boy was never a carefree existence, not with Murray Wilson as their hard-driving manager.
Murray wanted to be the producer. Now, maybe he thought he was in the beginning, and maybe he was in the beginning. But Murray became, as they say, a pain in the neck, and it really bothered Brian.
Brian, this is going to be a hell of a hit. Let's go. I'm a genius, too. Let's go, huh? Brian. Forget who you are, will you?
I think he was envious. I don't think he was jealous. I think he was envious, yeah. But more than anything, I think he was proud.
Come on, Brian, knock it off. Let's go.
That really gets that.
I don't care if it does. Let's go. Come on, you got any guts? Let's see it. I don't care how many people are here.
Got one ear left and your big loud voice is killing.
And he got to the point where it was so overbearing to work with him that we had to fire him. We fired him, you know.
By 1963, Brian had taken total control of the Beach Boys' records. Barely out of his teens, he co-wrote, arranged, produced, and sang on 28 top 40 hits.
It was a singles-driven business, and you had to come up with a single basically every 2.5, 3 months to stay in the game.
In just 3 years, Brian would produce an amazing 9 consecutive gold albums. But the arrival of the Beatles, Brian's responsibilities as the group's musical leader, and his ongoing battles with his father were taking an emotional toll. In late December of 1964, while on tour with the Beach Boys, Brian broke down.
I quit touring because I wanted to write songs at home. I couldn't write on the road very good, so I wanted to write at home so I could produce tracks for the boys to come in and sing to.
It was an arrangement that at first worked perfectly. In 1965, while the band was busy touring, Brian was at home in the studio, and everything about his life was changing.
I smoked some pot and I went, can I please have a glass of water? And he said, sure. And I said, I've never really tasted water in my life. This is the first time I've ever really tasted water. It tastes so fresh and clean and cold, you know.
He described waving staffs of music through the air, like Walt Disney, with notes on the staffs.
Yeah, I used to see notes. I used to visualize notes on paper with my mind, and then after I visualized it, I'd write it down as I verbatim as I saw it in my mind.
Brian was soaking it up, learning, talking. He'd want to know why, how, just endlessly curious, like any great mind. It's always curiosity.
I always wanted to learn and learn about life and about metaphysics and about spirituality, about philosophy and stuff like that. Yeah.
Brian believed that to grow creatively, his consciousness needed to expand, too. In the mid-1960s, that meant a then-legal drug called LSD.
I heard that it was a way to open doors to creativity, that you could unlock treasures of creativity and stuff like that.
I got him at my house one night, and I gave him 125 mics of purple liquid Owsley, the real stuff.
I was a little scared. I remember feeling afraid and like I felt like claustrophobia, you know what I mean? Like a scaredness of being confined.
Brian got higher and higher and higher. And then he said, I gotta get out of here. And he gets in the, he goes into the bedroom. This is wonderful. He goes in the bedroom. He puts his head under the pillow.
I'm afraid of my mom. I'm afraid of my dad. I was afraid of my parents, you know, because it heightens your awareness.
About an hour and a half later, he bursts out of the bedroom and says, well, that's enough of that. I said, I should think so, Brian.
During my first LSD trip, I went to the piano and I went. And I played it for a half hour, just and then finally, all of a sudden, I got. Then I got, well, East Coast girls are hip, I really dig those styles they wear. And I wrote it in a half hour. It took me a half hour to write it.
I believe that that trip changed everything in Brian's life, everything. And it did not make him crazy. And he began to write all the best songs of his career right from that point. Good Vibrations, Pet Sounds, all of it just emerged and from there.
I smoked some marijuana and listened to Rubber Soul and like Norwegian Wood and Michelle and all the songs. Blew my mind, just totally took my mind away. I thought to myself, God, they're so good, I feel competitive about this, you know? I said, I want to do something good like some Rubber Soul, you know?
Determined to beat the Beatles, Brian enlisted songwriter and advertising copywriter Tony Asher as his collaborator. In early 1966, when the Beach Boys returned from a tour of Japan, Brian played them the instrumental tracks for his new songs. What they heard was quite a departure from their previous album.
When they heard the tracks, they didn't like them. Because it wasn't surf music anymore, you know? It was like a notch up, a step up in creativity.
Record companies never want to take risks. They want to repeat the formula. And good artists don't do that. Good artists look for something new every time and try and build on what they had before. And so you don't listen to record companies. And you don't listen to frightened members of the band.
I thought they'd like it. I thought they'd really like it a lot. I mean, I was disappointed. Mike is the one who didn't like it the most.
He never was critical of what it was. He was just saying it wasn't right for the Beach Boys. And he was very aware of what he referred to as the formula.
They thought it was a little bit too arty and a little bit too much explorative in music.
They were saying this is not like what we've done before. So he saw that as a kind of a validation.
I told the guys, I said, look, we're going to go through this. We're going to get this done, you know. We're going to go through it, and we're going to get it done. And they did it.
The result was Pet Sounds, the emotional autobiography of its 23-year-old producer. It was an album that startled the music world.
Pet Sounds is probably really the most significant album of our generation.
I think Pet Sounds is one of the great albums.
We used to play that album all the time in the writer's room because we thought this is like the most incredible rock and roll album we'd ever heard.
I took an acetate of Pet Sounds to England before it was released, and I was at Andrew Oldham's house, and Paul McCartney came by.
We heard and devoured that acetate. It was absolutely amazing.
And watching the two of them listened to that and said, I'll take that one, I'll take that. Oh, there's a great riff.
I was raised in an agnostic family, and Pet Sounds actually gave me faith.
It floored me. I thought it was fantastic. And it gave the Beatles great inspiration. And it gave a challenge to them, too.
John and Paul called me after they heard Pet Sounds and told me how much they liked it. It was quite an honor for me.
On the charts, Pet Sounds went to number 10 and featured four top 40 hits, including Sloop John B, Wouldn't It Be Nice, and God Only Knows. At the same time that Brian unveiled the Beach Boys' new sound, he also enlisted former Beatles publicist Derek Taylor to remake his and the group's image.
You start hearing more about Brian Wilson and the genius of Brian Wilson, and you start looking at those records and listening to those records, and it much different way.
I think what Derek was doing that was smart was trying to legitimize Brian.
Derek made the connection between the Beatles and the Beach Boys, so I mean, it doesn't get much better than that if you want to make a transition, have people pay attention.
Derek saw the big picture. I think he was the guy letting the Beatles know, hey, you guys better watch out. you better work a little harder because he's doing stuff that's going to blow your mind.
The Beatles were going their way, and Brian was going his, and they were kind of looking over their shoulder and seeing what was coming up on the outside rail. And I think that was the effect of it. They wanted to experiment more. They wanted to do rather more outrageous things.
As did Brian. And in the spring of 1966, he began devoting his attention full-time to what was called a pocket symphony.
My mother told me one time about vibrations, and so I just put good on the front of good vibrations, and Mike came up with for the, you know, the I'm picking up good vibrations. He came up with that. That was the hook of the record.
Off and on for nearly 6 months, under growing pressure to deliver a hit single, Brian recorded and re-recorded dozens of pieces of music. Some in Brian's world wondered why his new production was taking so long, costing so much. The reasons were simple. He was determined to make the perfect record, and he would not compromise his vision. It was on Good Vibrations that Brian first employed his revolutionary modular recording style.
Brian was certainly experimenting a lot more with the recording process than anyone else in Los Angeles at that time.
When Brian was working in bits and pieces, almost like a crossword puzzle, he knew what he was doing.
There was no way to hear everything all together. How this minimalist part that you were being asked to come up with fit into this, what ultimately was this very sophisticated whole.
Writing it in sections was very easy, and we strung them all together. After we were done with the sections, we strung them all together, and it worked out just great.
I never considered it to be made in bits. I never really analyzed it like that. I just listened to it and reveled in it.
Good Vibrations was everything Brian had hoped for, a creative triumph and an instant worldwide hit.
When Good Vibrations came out, it knocked me out. I mean, I said, oh my God, what is happening? This is so incredible.
I remember it being, hearing it a few times, or hearing part of it, and then thinking, what the hell is that? You know, was that unusual?
What's going on here? It sounds like almost like a pop record, but it could certainly have been part of a symphony, but a modern symphony.
I used to have a 45 player in my Rolls Royce that had a special button on it for normal and stoned, okay? And his was one of the singles where you didn't need to press the stoned button. Never mind the fact that you sit there trying to work out how did he do it? How did he get this onto tape?
You know, it has to be Good Vibrations when he blows the industry away, when he blows the Beatles away. The recording of Good Vibrations is what everyone said, what's he gonna do next?
The success of Good Vibrations inspired me to keep moving in that same direction.
If Pet Sounds was his blue period, then SMiLE would have been his cubist period. I mean, it would have been that radical a move from one form of art to another, and would have influenced, I think, music at that time as much as Picasso's cubist period influenced art.
Determined to become even more adventurous, Brian needed a partner who could inspire him to greater heights, a lyricist whose wordplay would be as radical as Brian's music. His choice was Van Dyke Parks, a 22-year-old songwriter and session musician, a hip and educated member of the L.A. music scene.
I met him at Terry Melcher's house in 1965. He and I talked for a couple hours, and I said, you know, I've never met anybody like you who is so good with words, you know. I said, by any chance, do you have a lyrical ability? And he says, well, yeah, I can write lyrics. I said, well, do you want to get together and see what we can do?
I was startled that he suggested I write lyrics for him. I have no idea why I had that opportunity, but I think that it was just Brian's instinct.
I would listen to the radio and I'd hear the lyrics. I think, I want to create lyrics for Van Dyke that's about a notch up from the other lyrics that I was hearing. A little more artistic and poetic.
What I remember is the first thing we did was Heroes and Villains.
Oh, my God.
Whole bunch of notes.
In the key of C sharp.
Would you play a little bit of it?
I've been in the town so long and back in the city. I've been taken for lost and gone and unknown for a long, long time. Fell in love years ago with it.
Yeah.
All right.
That was cool. That was one of the highlights of my life, that song.
That scared the hell out of me. I mean, just as, in terms of words, as I recall it, we got lucky. We got some wind at our back. We sat there one day, and we knocked that thing to the... We knocked it to the ground right away.
We nailed it. We did.
It was the summer of 1966. America was in the midst of a tremendous upheaval, and Brian and Van Dyke wanted to tell the world a more optimistic story. A story about an America that was as good as its ideals.
I knew that he wanted to write a song that talked about good guys and bad guys, and maybe do some work where good would triumph over evil. And I like all that.
And I couldn't understand how my hands kept going over the keys. Too spontaneous, I thought. Maybe Van Dyke was in control. And I didn't worry about it, though. I just said, I'm not worried about it.
Well, I probably have never been so out of control. But, you know, I don't think it's not so important to me to feel like I'm in control.
Yeah.
That we're just going along exploring together. It was simple, straightforward, uncomplicated, collaborative heaven. It's heaven on earth.
I didn't think there'd be any limits to what he could do. I thought he was going to make the first true symphony, pop symphony.
He also talked about the spiritual nature of what he was trying to do. And I believe he described this project that he was working on or hoped to work on as a teenage symphony to God.
I did snap too when I actually heard him say, "One day I will write songs that people will pray to."
Brian was dealing in very cosmic thought processes. I've never been able to really put it into words, but he thought on a very large canvas. And it didn't have any rules, and it didn't have any specific dimensions. It was very much a universe, the way he would think about things. He would just go.
As a kid, Brian had loved to study the stars. As an artist, he felt he was in touch with the cosmos. But like everything else about him, the way he sought to express that spirituality was completely different.
He'd assign different animals. And of course, the first fight would be, "I want to be the wolf, I want to be," you know. And then we would make animal noises. So much of it was spontaneous. So much of it was with Brian, it was, at that time, was of the moment. And the joy of it would be of the moment.
Out in the barnyard, the chickens do their number. Out in the barnyard, the cook is chopping lumber.
The key word for Brian was humor. If you could get humor into the world, into any situation, you wouldn't have problems. That's the essence of Brian.
He felt that the moment somebody laughed, that while they're laughing, that all control is gone. They cannot control themselves. And at that moment, they can have a spiritual experience.
Van Dyke and I wanted to make a title that would catch people's ears so that they would want to hear it. So we said SMiLE, which we thought was a very appropriate title. So people would say, "Hey, what's this SMiLE all about? We want to see what SMiLE is all about."
Laughter was vital to Brian. But it was just one aspect of SMiLE. In part, the album was conceived as an American travelogue, a journey from Plymouth Rock to Diamond Head, as seen from the point of view of a bicycle rider who flew from coast to coast.
Brian Wilson was one of the first, if not the first guy around, who recognized and then utilized the studio's potential as an interactive part of the band and the performers' making of the record.
And I think he went into this very unique place where there were, he was creating the rules. No one had ever done what he was doing.
He's advancing how the equipment, how the engineer, and how those musicians are working. He's taking those elements and he's pushing them.
I have 4 tracks and I have 8 tracks. I can bounce things, I can layer things, I can stack things up. And all of a sudden the studio becomes one of the instruments that you're playing.
Over and over, the crow cries uncover the cornfield. Over and over, the pressure and hunger, the wheat field. Over and over, the crop flies uncovered, the cornfield. Over and over, the pressure and hunger, the wheat field.
At the same time that Brian embarked on this new musical journey, he also entered a period where his creativity extended into every realm of his life. His search for fun knew no bounds, and completely open to any new experience, musical or otherwise, he had the power to indulge his every whim.
Well, he decided one night that he wanted to, for all of us to be healthy. So he somehow got rid of all the furniture that was in the living room, and they were all, and I walked in, and the whole living room was just blue mats, blue tumbling mats.
Daddy said, sleep a lot, eat a lot, brush them like crazy, run a lot, do a lot.
I wasn't into physical fitness at that time, no. I wasn't into it.
Sleep a lot, eat a lot, brush them like crazy.
I wanted other people to exercise, but I really didn't want to do it. I was too lazy to do it.
Well, he would be the team leader and get everybody doing exercises in the pool. Come on, this is good for you. And then after a while, you start going, I don't know. It's cold out, man. I don't.
Yeah, there's a contradiction there that I didn't want to do it myself, but I wanted other people to do it.
I tried to kick the ball, but my titty flew right on. I'm ready.
Inspired by a radio evangelist, Brian became infatuated with the idea that eating vegetables was important, and he wanted to spread the word.
I threw away my candy bar and I ate the wrapper. And when they told me what I did, I burst into laughter. I know that you feel better when you send us in your letter. Your favorite vegetable.
Brian would then take the song and we'd have to act it out. If it was vegetables, we'd have to, I became, I think, David Carrot or Dave Carrot, whatever I was. And Mike Vossi was the celery.
I thought Brian was doing all of it with a great sense of humor. And let's keep in mind that this was a time when people were first starting to think about eating healthily. A lot of what he's saying made a lot of sense, and it was all delightful. See, those were not distractions. Those were organically part of the process of what he was doing. People who love Brian and people who want to identify him as some kind of nut have created. He wasn't. He was leading the charge. It's like Teddy Roosevelt, San Juan Hill, let's go.
Well, with Brian, there was never any doubt. If you wanted to do something, you just did it.
Come on over, Lauren. You won't believe this. Come on.
It just seems so bizarre when he's talked about it.
I just remember the sandbox appearing.
We had some people bring a sandbox into my living room, and we had it boxed off with wood so the sand wouldn't fall over the house. And Van Eyck and I worked on songs and sitting at the sandbox. My piano was right in the sandbox.
And it was thousands of pounds. The cleanest white sand you've ever seen, and this gorgeous Steinway grand.
When people come over to see it, they would say, what in the heck are you doing? You know, that's very creative.
When you saw it, and he'd be sitting there in bare feet, playing with his feet in the sand.
We sat barefooted, just like we gave us the feeling that we were on the beach.
You shut your eyes and you're feeling the sand. Then it made sense.
What really became the problems was the two dogs crapping in the sand.
And so what did you write in the sandbox?
We wrote Heroes and Villains, Cabin Essence, Surf's Up, and Wonderful in the sandbox.
It was a pretty good sandbox.
Yeah, it was a great sandbox, yeah.
This maybe is my favorite one. We have to have a tent. Okay, great, let's have a tent. We have to have a tent to have meetings. Okay, let's have a tent to have meetings.
The tent was an Arabian tent. A guy named Terry Sachin, who used to work for me, lined it up. He ordered the fabric and he had it installed in my house.
It looked great. It had big cushions in it.
Everything was always done very well.
I wanted to, so we could go inside and feel like we were in a tent and we didn't have to look around. You know? Somewhere to hide. You know?
We were all so excited about it. Anybody who thinks this was like Brian being wacko and everybody was staying the side going is wrong. Everybody wanted that tent to work. And it was certainly the most spectacular thing going on. Fast forward to it's finally finished. Brian has a bunch of people over.
You'd go in there and be like, you couldn't see the person across the tent the other side. So full of smoke. No vent. I said, Brian, why are you supposed to have a vent at the top? Teepees are built. Oh, no, don't want a vent.
What would you do when you were in the tent?
I'd eat sandwiches.
I remember to smoke hash, basically.
It is so stifling in there. That is impossible.
So Brian lasted about 10 minutes, as I recall, that first night. He was saying, I'm out of here.
But nobody wants to bag it, you know? Everybody wants to, like, do it. Then we had to figure out, how do we get air conditioning into this?
I can't say that nobody ever went in the tent after that, but it certainly wasn't the community center.
Well, eventually, of course, the farther away you get from the purity of it, the less important it becomes until all of a sudden there's no more tent.
In the fall of 1966, as the Beach Boys headed out on tour, Brian finished recording the instrumental tracks for the Sandbox songs, the centerpiece compositions of his and Van Dyke's collaboration.
Farther down, the path was a mystery. Through the recess, the chalk and numbers, a boy bumped into who won, wonderful.
Brian's sophisticated compositions needed the kind of players who were schooled in jazz and classical music, and he would only work with the best.
The musicians I used in the 60s to create records with all added their own touch, their own special touch to the records that I produced. This is Studio 3 at Western. This is where I recorded a lot of music. My drummer, Hal Blaine, was right over there on the left. Jamie Gloria on baritone sax, Steve Douglas on tenor, and Jim Horn on tenor were right there. Carol Kay on electric bass here, Ray Pohl on electric bass here, and Lyle Ritz on stand-up bass there. The keyboards, Don Randy and Larry Nechter were here, right there. And Julius Wechter was the percussionist, he played right there.
And where would the strings be?
The strings would be right over here. Four violins, four violas, and four cellos would be right here.
He'd go to the studio with an idea of what he wanted to do. He would explain to the guys what he was looking for. If they were having a problem with it, no matter what the instrument is, he'd pick the instrument up and he would play it. He would show them what he was thinking. Then he'd come in the control room and he would do the board. I mean, Brian was a total music maker.
Here's where the engineer was. Chuck Brooks was here. I was here producing. And our friends, the visitors, would be down there in chairs. And we'd get it on.
The clarinets, can I hear them, please? A little bit fast. And let's add to that double time thing. Let's don't come in fast. It speeds up a little bit now.
He went in there trying to get emotion out of them. And I think a lot of them were shocked because they were just used to playing the notes correctly, and he'd go in and say, no, I want you to lean on the note more. I make it sound like crying.
Oh, the clarinets blow a little harder, actually. Make it feel like a Dixieland thing in the room or something. Here we go.
We were working for Quincy Jones. We were working for Phil Spector. We were working for Gary Usher, and we were doing all the dates. So he was just one of our accounts. There was something special about him. That's what we noticed.
You could see it in his eyes. He was a constant thinker. He was planning ahead.
Hold it. No. You got to be faster. Look, you guys have got to play a little more this way or that way. And then they'd start, and he would just go over and over and over. No, one more time.
Quarter notes all the way now, yeah. Boom, 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 boom.
He heard sounds, combination of sounds that were not written before at all. And I think because he didn't have any rules.
When you shake in a tambourine, you know, make it sound like jewelry or tinkling or like wind chimes with wind, you know, wind softly, a warm breeze slowly going through the wind chimes. So he talked in a different way to them.
Beautiful. Now it sounds like jewelry. Here we go. One, two, three, go.
He was creating something really, really big and broad and beautiful, so something very rare.
He was the hottest, most plugged-in person in music, in my opinion. Above the Beatles, above any other act, he was the man.
He was producing, he was performing, and he was writing and arranging. So that's what floored me later on. I thought, why does this guy have so much talent? It's not fair.
At night, after the recording sessions, Brian and his friends would gather, and he would play them the SMiLE music, explaining how it could all fit together. Having written and recorded in a modular style, the verse or chorus of one song might become the bridge of another.
Brian would come back from the studio sometimes with little pieces that he had recorded, and we would sit around in a circle or whatever, and he would play these things, these bits of music, and we would go, oh my God. And then Brian would say, this is Cabin Essence, and this is, and oh no, Brian, that's perfect as wonderful. This is, you know, so we would argue with him about, oh, you can't make that change. And then he would make the change, and we go, oh man, that is so cool. So that's what I did. I said a lot of that is so cool.
Brian was constantly coming up with new ways to blow people's minds. David Anderle was setting up a record company that would be an outlet for all of Brian's musical experiments. Dreams were coming true.
When you have that kind of energy and it's creative, and then you got a lunatic like me who believes anything is possible as long as it's good, we thought we could do it.
It felt real, almost made me dizzy. We were on such a creative roll, I almost got dizzy. I almost got dizzy.
Good Vibrations was the group's first million-selling single, and with it, Brian and his team were on an enormous high. The Beach Boys reached a new peak in popularity, and Brian himself was attracting the attention of the most important American maestro in the world of classical music.
For a long time now, I've been fascinated by this strange and compelling scene called pop music.
Leonard Bernstein, you know, New York, CBS, big step.
I think this music has something terribly important to tell us adults, and we would be wise not to behave like ostriches about it. Besides, as I said, I like it. Of course, what I like is maybe 5% of the whole output, which pours over this country like the two oceans from both coasts, and it's mostly trash. But that good 5% is so exciting and vital and may I say significant, that it claims the attention of every thinking person.
Leonard Bernstein was quite infatuated with Pet Sounds and quite interested in Brian because he could hear in that music something that he wasn't hearing in very much pop music at all. And certainly not in American pop music, which were the roots of classical composition, original composition.
All these new adventures are simply extraordinary.
He came out in a television show and said, "This is an important contribution to American popular music of the 20th century."
Many of the lyrics, in their oblique allusions and way-out metaphors, are beginning to sound like real poems.
So that gave us some kind of validation that we were doing the right thing to explore, to try to get outside the box.
Now, what does all this mean? I think it's all part of a historic revolution.
Carbonated ruins dying.
There is a new song, too complex to get all of first time around. It could come only out of the ferment that characterizes today's pop music scene. Brian Wilson, leader of the famous Beach Boys and one of today's most important pop musicians, sings his own Surf's Up.
Dove nested towers, the hour was struck, the straight quicksilver moon. Carriage across the fog, two step to lamplight salute. Of the wine, the dim last toast, while it poured into our time. A choke of grief, heart hardened I'm, the unbelief of broken man, too tough to cry.
On Surf's Up, what were you feeling when you wrote the music? Do you know?
I was feeling some love, a little bit of love, and I felt like you were there, and I just felt some love. Yeah. I felt a whole lot of love.
Well, it shows. It's just very romantic music.
There was a whole lot of love going on at that time.
Yes.
Surf's up.
Beautiful even in its obscurity, Surf's Up is one aspect of new things happening in pop music today. As such, it is a symbol of the change many of these young musicians see in our future.
It almost seems to me that Surf's Up is like a premonition of what was going to happen to our generation and what was going to happen to our music. That some great tragedy that we could absolutely not imagine was about to befall our world. There are some really very disturbing, clairvoyant images in Surf's Up that seem to say, watch out, this is not gonna last.
At that point, things were going along in such a strong direction that it never occurred to me that anything would stop SMiLE on any level whatsoever.
The SMiLE era was one inspiring and mind-blowing moment after another. While the Beach Boys were being received royally in England, Brian was at home, feverishly working in the studio, developing a suite that would express the four ancient elements: earth, air, fire, and water. The fire element was named Mrs. O'Leary's Cow, after the legendary creature that had kick-started the Chicago Fire.
Everything was being played out somehow. It was like being taken even to another step. It wasn't just music now. It was like life. in a funny, kind of humorous way.
Recording Fire was like, we brought fire helmets for the musicians, little toy fire hats, and I brought in a bucket of fire, and it made the mood come real good, you know, go real good.
All of a sudden, the wheel in the trash barrel on fire was not conducive to breathing.
Don't worry, it won't be on the record. You know, they won't hear it.
Oh, that's great.
Now, remember, there would have been 5, 6, 7 of these going on at once. Everybody had a whistle. Almost like a New Year's Eve party, you know, to parallel it that way. Everybody was just having fun, and the guys loved it.
Fire was a little bit bizarre for me to go through. It was a little bit of a bizarre sound, but we did it. It's very different off-the-wall music, so it's not your, you know, it's not like Surfer Girl or you know, Be True to Your School. Feeling unhappy, so I thought that fire tape would express the crazy, weird thoughts I was going through.
Down the street from the studio, there was a warehouse that burned down to the ground. It burned to the ground. And I thought it was my fault when we did the fire tapes that day. I thought that the fire tapes, the songs that we, the music that we created about fire, I thought that was responsible for the building burning down to the ground.
There was like, all of this was so much fun. And I was watching the guy in crisis. And I knew that all of a sudden, if this was a joke, it was at someone's expense. And whose expense was it but Brian's?
Perhaps more than anything, Mrs. O'Leary's cow was a marker, the first sign of real paranoia. Adding fuel to the fire, the Beach Boys were about to return from their triumphant tour of England.
Before the Beach Boys came back from England, I was a little worried that they wouldn't like what I was doing.
Support is really important. For Brian, it was critical. I mean, no to Brian was really not a good thing.
I knew how good it was, but I thought that they would think it was too far into a new creative bag.
When the boys got back from England, I mean, that was the major no.
They said, hey, that's too creative. We don't like that. And I said, well, give me a break. I'm trying something new.
They came into town as triumphant heroes, and they found that the town had changed. You know, the people had moved into their life with Brian, strangers that weren't part of any Beach Boy history that they knew of. I think they were ready to really start kicking some butt as the Beach Boys. And bingo, they run into this whole new thing. I mean, I totally understand how they could be nervous, scared, and pissed off.
I've been in this town so long to the city. I'm fit with the stuff to ride in the rough. And sunny down snuff, I'm all right. By the heroes and
he was in the habit of getting all the support and cooperation he needed.
I thought maybe they wouldn't like it at first, but I knew they'd get used to it as soon as they heard it all.
He didn't get the support that he could have used. I think the issue isn't what he needed or could have used. But I think the question is that he didn't get what he should have had. And that bugged him deeply.
When they said they didn't like it, it hurt my feelings a lot. Really did. It really killed me inside. Yeah.
I think it was the start of him having doubts, which he never had.
I'd done the tracks, and I needed their voices on the tracks. Even though I could sing all the parts, I still needed them to do it. I needed that blend, that Beach Boy blend. I knew they were right. They didn't know, but I knew. They didn't think they were right for it, but I knew they were right for it.
Despite their initial reaction, the group went to work recording vocals. For months, Brian struggled to integrate the Beach Boys into his and Van Dyke's vision, but it seemed that nothing the group did gave Brian peace of mind or artistic satisfaction.
It was awful to watch because the procedure was always Brian going into the studio with the guys and going over the parts with them in the past. And he was doing that with these lyrics.
The music hall, a costly bow. The music all is lost for now. To a muted trumpeter swan. Columnated ruins domino.
These were almost like puzzles to try to figure out what the heck he was talking about.
There was a huge amount of frustration. You could see Brian becoming very frustrated. Mike was trying to make sense out of it. Carl was being diplomatic about it, and Dennis was going, "We can do it, Bri."
They knew it was good music, but they didn't think it was right for them.
Outside the studio, Brian's self-imposed pressures continued to escalate. In early 1967, Brian believed he was in the midst of a production race, and if you were to be the first with the new sound, weeks could make a difference.
One night, Brian and I were driving to Dolores's for him to get burgers and fries and pie. And he turned on the radio and something came on from the Beatles.
I was on Tecanol, you know, those kind of pills, downers. And I was real relaxed. And when Strawberry Fields came on the radio, I like locked in with it. I locked right in with it and like took me, I had to pull over to my car over to the side, listen to it. And I said, "I've never heard anything like this in my life."
And he just shook his head and he said, "They did it already." And I said, "They did what?" And he said, "What I wanted to do was smile. You know, maybe it's too late." And I just started laughing my head off. And he started laughing his head off. So I always, you know, I never gave that much import to that. But the moment he said it, he sounded very serious.
By now, Brian was over 6 months into SMiLE. In his entire career, no album had ever taken so long to finish. Some songs were incomplete, and the biggest creative challenge still facing him was how to sequence the pieces of music.
I knew I needed at least a year more to work on it, and I figured no one would give me a year to complete it.
SMiLE is the name of the new Beach Boys album, which will be released in January 1967, and with a happy album cover, the really happy sounds inside, and a happy in-store display piece you can't miss. We're sure to sell a million units in January.
Capitol was anxious for the record, and they didn't want to wait a year. But as the group continued to work on their vocals, Brian faced increasing resistance.
There were recording sessions where people wouldn't participate. There were meetings where it was discussed that this wasn't going well. My sense was that Mike Love felt that the SMiLE thing was too far out for the Beach Boys. He knew that the Beach Boys had a winning formula in what they did and what they wrote about, and he didn't want to go this other way.
Mike did not like SMiLE at all. He hated it. He hated it.
And then it got very complex, and I think too complex for Brian at that time. Started interfering with the music.
Brian made it clear to me that he wanted to do something without restraint or apology or explanation to the rest of the group. And he honestly felt that I was a big enough guy to handle the door. There's no question of that. I wasn't a big enough guy.
Van Dyke was being called to task by a certain member of the Beach Boys over Columnated Ruins Domino and saying, "What does that mean?"
If you're writing music that is almost completely without precedent, then why wouldn't you have words that are the same?
It sure is tedious to have to explain lyrics to people. And it wasn't something I wanted to do for a living.
I didn't know how to deal with it. I really didn't. I didn't know how to deal with it.
Brian's ability to stand up for what he believed in depended entirely on who he had to stand up against. I think the difficulty arose when he was dealing with family.
He didn't want to offend anybody. He didn't want to confront anybody.
I think he started getting pummeled mentally.
The resistance was like something I didn't like. I didn't like the resistance at all. I didn't like it.
It was clear to me, I think probably before anyone else, that Brian was headed for an emotional collapse.
I kept moving forward, even though I didn't want to, you know.
The Beatles were on the verge of releasing their production masterpiece, Sgt. Pepper. Brian's was long overdue, and now, after the months of hard work, it appeared that SMiLE was falling apart.
I got tired of it. I just got tired of the direction we were going in, you know? I didn't like it.
The internal tug of war was tearing Brian apart. Some believed that the biggest factor affecting his ability to finish the album was his use of drugs.
I think they helped him just work longer hours. I don't think they got in the way at all.
Don't let the marijuana confuse the issue here. If you look at the amount of work that was done and the amount of time it took to almost finish it, it's amazing. It's a very athletic situation and very focused.
I just think whatever the hell Murray did about getting private detectives to look into Brian's drug use, that drugs is the biggest red herring in the Brian Wilson story I've heard so far. I just don't buy it.
It was an extremely confusing time for Brian. He was no longer sure who he could trust. He thought he was being spied upon, that his phones were being tapped, that his car and house had been bugged.
He called me one time and wanted to have a meeting, and it was maybe 3 or 4 in the morning. And I went up to the house, and we had to have the meeting in the middle of the pool because they can't bug a pool. This was, for me, the beginning of the end of the humor, joy, happiness, love. I don't know where it was coming from, but there was definitely a paranoia growing in his head.
You were my sunshine, my only sunshine. You made me happy when skies were gray.
When he saw the painting I did of him the first time, he immediately got into counting certain dots and things that I had in the painting, and he was getting some sort of numerological reading from that, of which, of course, I was totally unaware of when I was doing it. From that point on, from the time he saw the painting on, my relationship with him was starting to change. I felt a change.
Is it hot as hell in here, or is it me? It really is a mystery. If I try before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take my misery.
I think he was becoming confused emotionally. I think a lot of issues that had been festering inside this guy, that he had managed to compartmentalize so that he could make his music, may have burst out of their boundaries.
I couldn't even sit here and tell you if it was a week, a month, 2 months, day, whatever, from how fast the collapse happened in terms of me and them and Brian. It was so fast.
I think it's time for the proper respect given to absolute authority, and that should be given to an artist. And if there's any artist who deserved that, in my mind, at the very point I turned tail and walked away from the project, it was Brian Wilson. But it was not within my power to bring that to him. And that is a great regret.
In March of 1967, further complicating the situation, the Beach Boys filed suit against Capitol Records. Frustrated by the circumstances surrounding the project, Michael Vossi, David Anderley, and Van Dyke Parks all departed.
God, the forces he was fighting, the guys, his dad, the label, I don't think he could have done it alone. He would have needed his little army to help him.
He didn't lose his sense of control or purpose until well after I'd found my exit, but I knew that was the death knell.
Brian Wilson's musical revolution wasn't to be. Despite all of the wonderful sound that had been composed and recorded, despite all of the publicity that had the world waiting for this incredible album, Brian put it on the shelf.
I'll tell you from my heart. In 1967, the reasons why I didn't finish SMiLE was Mike didn't like it. I thought it was too experimental. I thought that the fire tape was too scary. I thought that people wouldn't understand where my head was at that time. Those were the reasons.
Knowing Brian, it doesn't surprise me at all that those pressures and whatever other chemicals or influences that he was having to deal with, that he would shut down. It seems like the natural thing to do under those circumstances.
It's just that I felt personally beaten up by it, because I didn't complete it. I felt beaten up.
He just went somewhere else. He checked out. Or it checked out. I don't know if he made a conscious decision for him to get sick the way he did. He just got sick.
I did have a breakdown. I had a nervous breakdown.
Saying to myself, in the universe, I'm so small that it's an absurdly small idea to think of how small you really are in the universe. And I went to the piano and I said, what are some ways that I can express being small? So I thought, I'm a cork on the ocean, I'm a rock in a landslide, I'm a leaf on a windy day.
I'm a leaf on a windy day. Pretty soon
For 30 years, as the beautiful dream of SMiLE made its sad journey from reality to myth, Brian himself was caught in a cycle of self-destructive behavior. Among other problems, he was suffering from undiagnosed depression.
I was on a slow downhill slide at that time, and I kept sliding and sliding and sliding until I came to a stop.
Brian's life was turned around by a single act of faith. In 1995, he got married. Melinda Wilson made sure that Brian finally received proper psychiatric care, and after years of isolation, she gave Brian what he called emotional security.
I think what happened with him in terms of wanting to make music again and taking it serious was the fact that he had a different environment, a loving home, a loving wife, something that he hadn't had for years. And that seemed to be the spark that it took for him to become creative and want to be in the music world again.
As the 20th century came to an end, one of its greatest composers began a most improbable artistic reinvention. He became a concert performer.
It was a real way for him to face the demons of the past in terms of touring. So it was a healing experience. It was an experience for him to be able to go out and get the love that he never really got from the fans.
I've never seen such love for an artist. It oozes out of that audience. They all want to take him home.
With a remarkable band devoted to Brian and his music, his most ambitious works could finally be played live.
I saw him at the Hollywood Bowl when he did Pet Sounds. They did the entire album of Pet Sounds, and I thought, wow, that was a great, great musical evening.
He's younger now. He's 5 years younger. He hasn't got 5 years old. He's got 5 years younger. It's unbelievable. And it obviously is the power of the music and him doing what he loves. Brian's come to life, and it's wonderful to see it.
Brian feels comfortable at a piano. In fact, they often put one in his dressing room because not only to have him work out things that he wants to work out, but just he likes having a keyboard around.
I had a holiday party, and I told Brian, hey, feel free to tickle the ivories. And then all of a sudden he starts playing and singing Heroes and Villains.
When I heard those notes and I knew it was him, I came rushing in.
Our mouths just dropped, and Scott ran into the room, and it was like, what is this?
This was very special, and everyone was quite aware of it. Everyone was quiet. I mean, everyone was listening and being not wanting to disturb the moment because no one had ever heard him do that before.
After Brian had completed the song, I don't remember who it was, but somebody said to him, gee, Brian, you need to do that at the tribute show, which was to happen the following spring. And he goes, oh, okay. It was like, I almost fell over.
I mean, we have to remember that, what, only a few months earlier, you couldn't even talk about Heroes and Villains with Brian. You bring it up and he says, I don't want to talk about it, or no comment. Or he'll say it's inappropriate, whatever.
All right, I did it.
So in 2001, at a Radio City Music Hall tribute in his honor, Brian took to the stage and for the first time in over 30 years performed Heroes and Villains. It was on this night that Brian saw that the music of SMiLE was not inappropriate, that it was not weird, that it was, very simply, beloved.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much! It made me think, it gave me the confidence that the world was ready for this music, yeah.
She belongs there, left with her liberty.
In the spring of 2003, Brian went to London to announce the impossible, that he would be performing SMiLE live.
After all this time, he can't not do it. He has to finish SMiLE.
That's incredible. That's a wonderful thing for him to do.
I was sure about this, you know, is this going to happen? Is this a wind-up? Is it really going to be SMiLE? How can it be SMiLE? What is SMiLE?
Could it really be right to ask him to do now what he hadn't done 37 years ago?
So it was the most
discussion-provoking thing that the man could possibly have done.
I mostly thought the fact that he couldn't pull it off. I thought the weight of it would conjure up all these memories and all these things, and then you add in the expectation.
First of all, I just didn't know if Brian was emotionally ready for it, because, you know, there was all these legends about, you know, what SMiLE meant or did to him.
Once Brian announced SMiLE, things changed a little bit. Like, the excitement, the warmth, and the enthusiasm basically turned to, oh no, this is really gonna happen, and it's gonna take me back to some really pretty hard times in my life.
You know, he could have just let this sit. I mean, it's the most famous unreleased album of all time. And just let the legend live.
But Brian had made his decision. However, there was a new delivery date for the still unfinished work. An audience would be in their seats on February 20th, 2004.
When I got back from London, I said to myself, how am I going to do this? How am I going to get this SMiLE stuff done?
Aside from bad memories, he's also thinking, oh my God, that's difficult music. You know, it's complex. And he's thinking about the responsibility and having to teach the band parts. It's all of a sudden, it's like, it becomes a stack of dirty dishes that he has to wash, you know? It's like, ah, I don't want to do that.
I just pep-talked myself into it, to getting into the SMiLE.
So to break the ice, it was all about, hey, Brian, we're not trying to finish an album here. We're just, how do we perform this music in a way that it would flow?
I approached it one song at a time. One at a time.
And I think that made him feel a little better. Then he can think of it in a modern context of how we're going to be performing this music on a stage in front of people. And that was less scary for him, I think.
Maybe not one.
In my mind, Darian's an unsung hero on the SMiLE project. If it weren't for him and Brian feeling so comfortable with his assistance, I don't think it would have happened.
Wonderful you.
Wonderful. Yeah, we'll do that. Yeah. We'll give him that much.
For Brian, the key to finishing SMiLE had always been how to sequence the music. To do that, in 2003, Darian loaded all of Brian's original SMiLE tracks into his computer so that Brian could instantly hear them in any order.
So then we have that, but then we also have sections like this.
Father of the man, father of the man.
So then, and then another section that's on that same reel is this.
Wow. Is that just before Surf's Up?
It sort of has that vibe, doesn't it? It could
work. Reminds me of it. It has that kind of thing going.
With Darian acting as musical secretary, Brian boldly and confidently assembled the songs and surviving fragments into a final, coherent piece.
We touched up the first two movements, and we created a third movement. Now we have a rock opera, a three-movement rock opera.
It's like a long journey. It's like a trip around the world in a lot of ways. And in fact, if from what I understand of Brian and Van Dyke's original concept, this whole idea of traveling from Plymouth Rock to Hawaii, like the easternmost part of the United States to the westernmost. I really feel like we're traveling and doing that journey, you know.
Another challenge for Brian was that some of the songs just weren't finished. No lyrics or melodies had ever been put on tape. Amazingly, during one session with Darian, Brian remembered a long-lost melody.
Wave from the ocean liner.
I was just kind of sitting there stunned.
Thank you.
So we're working on it. We get to one word, and Brian gets stuck on it. And he's trying to sing it. He's like, God damn it! What is that word? He picks up the phone and starts dialing.
Hi, Van Dyke, this is Brian. You know the song, Do You Like Worms?
Brian called me to ask me what an indecipherable word was. And that word was Indians. And I'm so glad I could remember it.
I needed Van Dyke to come in and write lyrics for these melodies that never had lyrics.
Of course, the following day, I show up at the house, and there's Brian to greet me, as he always does. He says, hey, Darian, how's it going? I'm going good. Van Dyke's going to be here in 15 minutes. And I was like, oh, my God.
Can you get some words to it?
Mm-hmm.
You really can?
Yeah, come on, man. I didn't come to sit on the bench, coach. I came to...
sit on the floor.
I came to sit on the floor.
We both feared that the consequences of any further involvement might be as painful as the last ones.
I can tell there's a little bit of anxiety with him, you know? He's a little nervous.
Is it hot in here?
Is it hot as hell?
Is it hot as hell in here? Or is it me? It really is a mystery.
Yeah, I can do that. I can learn that, yeah.
I was immediately very surprised and pleased about how much life force was in the music.
We're running on 12 cylinders here.
Yes.
I'm running on none.
You're doing great.
Good work. I think what she's done is very, very creative, and I think that people are going to get the fuck off on it.
I think it's a feature
movie. I think it's going to get people off.
It's a feature movie, for sure.
I think it's an animated movie.
It could.
I do. I think it's an animated feature movie.
Thank you, man.
I love you.
Everybody loves you. Everyone loves you, man.
I love you very much. I just want to do good work.
Seemed like they just sort of picked up where they left off.
All right, man.
Lots of love, Darian. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Woo! Wow, Darian. Now that took my... blew my fucking mind.
Three, four.
SMiLE was finished, finally. And as 2004 began, Brian's band gathered at his home to begin vocal rehearsals.
It was all there, you know, everyone did their homework. And when we came in the first day, I mean, it was awesome. I mean, the vocals were all together and amazing.
I thought it sounded phenomenal. I thought our leader couldn't have been less interested in what was going on. And I thought, boy, if this is going to be an uphill battle to get him to want to do this, we're really going to have a struggle on our hands.
Hey, Wilson,
eventually
I've got notes too.
I'll stop. How are you feeling today?
So-so.
You all right?
Yeah.
Anything we can do for you?
No.
You can just chill and listen to the harmonies, absorb the music.
Okay.
Yeah, that first week of vocal rehearsals was really rough.
Nick and I, Brian, do father of the child, and then we say another child, a low child, and then you sing. So listen for that low child.
Low child.
Okay, let's do it.
One, two, three.
Child,
father of the son.
Child.
Brian really didn't seem like he was very involved. He didn't seem like he wanted to be there at all. And in fact, that was my main worry.
I had the feeling like I didn't want to be there. I was scared to smile, yeah. I thought I was going to bring back the bad feelings, yeah.
I really felt bad. He seemed incredibly nervous. He would just pretty much sit there.
If you feel like singing, if you feel like joining.
I was going through some real tough stuff, you know, and I wasn't able to relate too well. So I sat there and I must have looked like I wasn't having a very good time.
Oh, one, two, three.
Home did water. Home did water. Actually, there was a day when Brian was not feeling well about doing this tour.
I was nervous about my career. You know, I was thinking to myself, I'm too old. I'm too old to have a career. And I was paranoid about being 60 years old. You know what I mean? So I said, I'm going to get out of here.
Goodbye.
Aloha Nui means goodbye. I gotta go.
He ended up in the hospital.
Yeah, I was going through some inner turmoil, you know, that kind of stuff, yeah.
So we go to the hospital, and there he is laying on this gurney, you know, like, you know. And we start questioning him, asking him, you know, what's going on here? Well, you know, I'm, you know, getting nervous about the tour and this and that and the other, and then all of a sudden, I thought, okay, I'm going to cut through this BS right away. I go, Brian, do you want to go to dinner? And it was like, oh! Yeah, I want to go to dinner.
You know, every day is different.
So looking around, listening to the harmonies, it's like, wow, he's absorbing it. He's absorbing the music. He's not actually going through the motions of rehearsing, but mentally, it's part of the process.
As we came to a close on that first week of vocals, Brian became way more involved, certainly than, way more involved than the first day.
Aloha, Nui means goodbye.
You got it! Excellent.
I can do it when you double with me. If I'm on my own, I can't do it.
Ah, you can.
When I'm on my own, I can't. I can't.
Eventually you will. Don't sell yourself short. Okay. We'll be your crutch for just temporarily.
Okay.
Here we go.
Jump in the pig pen, next time I'll take my shoes off. Hit the dirt, do two and a half, next time I'll leave my hat on.
When Brian started to sing, I felt at ease, and I knew that it wasn't just so much that this was his stamp of approval, it's that now he's participating in all of this, and that's what we need. In a weird way, and I know this is, you hear this cliche all the time, but this is therapy for him too. On some level, it really is, beyond just it being music. You know, he has to get over this somehow.
But she's still dancing in the night and afraid of what a doodle did a child.
We are way beyond where I thought we'd be on Friday.
Now it really feels like it's all flowing, and I really feel it from the group that we're actually putting some heart and soul into this, where before it was like, what's my part?
It feels like it's, you know, we're bringing it to life.
I'm very excited to hear us with the band now. I mean, I'm like falling deeper and deeper in love with this music, so it's really cool. I can't wait till Monday.
What do you think, boss?
I think it's gonna be a bitch to learn, and it's worth it.
We are not trying to recreate the mystique of SMiLE. We're trying to play the songs live as best we can in the year 2004.
You know, just the idea that it's titled SMiLE is I mean, it could be literal SMiLE, but it's also slightly ironic in the fact that we all know Brian. You know, he's got a lot of problems and he's really sad. So there's that wanting to SMiLE.
It's groundbreaking music. I think he was writing from his heart, and I think it was just way ahead of its time. I don't know if at the time if people would have appreciated it as much as they're going to appreciate it now. I mean, the anticipation has been building for 35 years.
We'll hear what it sounds like when everything's together. We don't want it to sound like
Ozzy.
Yeah, we don't want it to sound like Ozzy either.
Okay, we still have to work on fire. We still have to work on vegetables.
I don't want Brian to come here.
Barnyard.
I don't want Brian to walk in during fire.
Okay. Yeah.
The first time we started playing, Brian wasn't there.
We were just doing a run through of it. Getting the tempos, getting the sounds, and I actually was thinking, wow, this is kind of historical. I don't know that fire has ever been performed.
We were all a little scared. We, you know, the tune's got so much legend behind it, and I don't even know what they all are, but I know they're big.
Jimmy counts it off, and we start jamming, you know. Doom, go doom, 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 doom. The power goes down.
All the sound, everything went out. In the entire place.
And all I kept thinking was, thank God Brian's not here.
Good thing Brian's not here.
He would freak out and not want to do the album.
I said, you know, maybe God doesn't want this music played. We better think about replugging this stuff in.
I know we were all eager to do this. I think we all wanted to do it, and we all wanted him to do it because we wanted him to get over this hump.
He's so nervous about this, and he associates a lot of rejection with this music.
He's a very private person. We can only guess what he's scared about. I mean, I'm hoping that he has rid himself of the weight of 67 or whatever demons came from that time. I'm hoping have been shed, but they may not have been.
Hey, Bri, what do you think?
Sounds good here.
Kind of a trip, huh? It's gonna be a fun part.
And if we can pull this off, and he can get through this, I think it's gonna be one of the bravest things he's ever done.
I think the first couple of weeks during rehearsal, Brian was actually feeling effects of his illness. When he's depressed, a lot of times auditory hallucinations will come into his head.
In 1965, I started hearing voices. After I took LSD, I started hearing these voices saying, "We're gonna kill you, we're gonna kill you." And I would say, "Don't kill me, please don't kill me." And I'd carry on a conversation with these auditory hallucinations, as they're called. Over the years, for a couple of months, they would fade out of my life and they come back in my life. So I've had a hard time with it, but I'm getting through it. Slowly, slowly getting through it.
Is it hot as hell in here, or is it me? It really is a mystery. If I die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take my misery.
It's really gutsy. It's taking a tremendous amount of work. I've never seen Brian work so hard.
I could really use a drop to drink.
Down. 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 You got it.
All right.
You got me.
Most people don't know the daily battles that he has to go through just to be on a steady state and to play music and to perform and to send it out into the audience. That takes a lot.
Too tough to cry. Surf's up, aboard a tidal wave. Come about hard and join the young. And off in spring you came. I heard the word, wonderful thing, a children's song.
I think with Brian, he waits until he really needs to do it, you know, to do it.
I see Brian getting more confident and also getting more excited about the music day by day.
I felt this like, it's like a sea change where you don't even see the iceberg moving, but you sort of feel it.
He just seemed to come alive, and he really sang with a voice that I haven't heard, I don't think, ever.
All right. Very good. That was one of the best.
Love you, man. This is strong and good. I'm serious. They're going to love
it.
This
is strong. It is good. I looked at a picture in Playboy today, and it threw me off the track. I'm off the track. Ready to go, guys? Are you ready to go?
Ready to rock!
Are you ready to go?
To rock!
The kid in him is still very much there, very much alive. I can see it when he does this material.
Today I saw Brian having fun. I haven't seen that in a long, long time. Definitely not in these last 3 weeks, but even way before this, I've not seen him just goof off like that.
Which is, it's a great sign because he's having fun with the music. I don't think he's afraid of it anymore.
It's been like, we can do SMiLE? All right, you know, and that makes me feel great.
Sunshine, my only sun.
I started smiling today. Just today I started.
This is a big thing, man. Those people over there in England are gonna get it, man.
God, it's good, bro.
Happy with it.
Yeah, sounds good. It's a lot of work, I know, to put all this together.
Yeah.
I've always told everybody, I said that this was your greatest piece of work, though, you know. Cat Sounds was good. Was good, you know. But this, you just climbed another mountain with this stuff.
I know.
So, yeah, I'm so glad to see you go back and get this done.
From the top, one time, please. From the top, one, two. One, two, three, go.
We're actually starting to feel the music. And that's important here because this is what this music's all about.
We're trying to cast a spell, a magical spell.
And it hits you every minute you're with him, every minute you're playing his stuff. There's all that deep, complicated stuff that just affects you.
I'm picking up the vibration. She's giving me the excitation. I'm picking up the vibration. She's giving me the
That tempo is awesome. Awesome.
You're gonna show those tea bags a thing or two. You're gonna show them.
I'm looking forward to it, but with absolute uncertainty and excitement bordering on fear. I keep thinking that there can be no more downside to this risk of getting out there and getting up on the high wire without the net, which is what he will be doing.
Just probably a week before he left, and he just started phoning every night, and sometimes he'd phone four or five times. Just say, I'm feeling scared.
I'm nervous as hell, yeah. I am.
Tell me what you're nervous about.
I'm nervous about just doing the show. I'm just about doing the show.
I actually got really nervous before we left to go on tour. I really felt that emotionally he was going backwards, and yet at the same time, when I would say to him, okay, do you not want to do this? No, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I have to do it.
Colchester, Connecticut, to see SMiLE tonight in London for the world premiere.
I'm from Italy.
All the way from Tokyo.
From Cape Town, South Africa.
I'm from Sweden.
Glasgow.
Copenhagen, Denmark.
I'm from Germany.
I come from Austria.
France. Paris.
Portland, Oregon.
Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Billings, Montana.
Came out from L.A.
We were there. We were in London. That was it. That was the first night. It was, you know, do or die.
I thought it was complete impossibility.
Very courageous.
For me, it's just a resurrection of the human spirit.
You wouldn't believe just how wobbly my heart is tonight.
It's just amazing music, you know, and you don't hear anything like that.
It bypasses the brain and goes straight to the heart.
I'm going to see something that people 400 years from now are going to be envious of.
I mean, this is really the holy grail for a whole bunch of people.
You could reckon the two, Excalibur's been stuck on a rock for so long, and now, like, King Arthur's brain's going to pull it out and wield its power tonight.
It's a dream come true.
The most thrilling moment in my life.
I'm going to have, like, my life pre-SMiLE, my life post-SMiLE.
The longest gestation in history. The guy gets pregnant in 1966 and he has the baby in 2004. That alone is worth the price of admission.
The life force of this process is a living one. It's a contemporary experience. It is one man dealing with his own musical history. It just takes a lot of moxie, a lot of courage for Brian Wilson to be willing to do this.
Give me a kiss.
All right. No
yeah.
Talks.
Okay.
I'm sorry, man.
It's okay.
I'll draw a line.
All right, I want you to enjoy the next one.
Oh.
For you.
You're just so good.
Okay.
Before the concert, I remember him telling me, I'm really scared. The stakes were really high. He didn't want to disappoint anyone, and I didn't want to see him disappointed.
I was scared enough to where I didn't think I was going to be able to do the show. I thought I was going to have to cancel the show. And I said, but if I cancel the show, I'm going to catch hell from the promoter. And, you know, no, it's not going to go over with the promoter. So I said, I can't cancel the show. So I said, what'll I do? I said, there's nothing I can do except sit and meditate for a half hour until it's showtime.
I think his concentration was, okay. I'm going to present my greatest piece of music to the public, and I am scared to death. And he dwelled on it. I mean, he dwelled on it until right before he went on the stage.
Anything like this before, where we heard about SMiLE being made at the time when we were in the 60s, and we were so excited, we were waiting for it, and rumors were it was great, but we never heard anything, and it was coming out and we were waiting for it, and it never happened. We waited in vain, and I never thought we'd hear it, and now we've got it, and it's fantastic.
I love the colorful clothes you wear, and she's already working on my brain. I looked in her eyes, but it picked up something I just can't explain. And I'm picking up vibrations. She's giving me excitation. I'm picking up vibrations. She's giving me excitation. I know what she's like, and I feel how right she'd be for me. It's weird how she comes in so strong, and I wonder what she's picking up from me. And I'm picking up, I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitation. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitation. Opportunity. Hello. Hold it, hold.
Thank you.
I'd like to take this opportunity to invite my friend and collaborator, Van Dyke Parks, up to the stage here. When we finished SMiLE, it felt like the demons had left me. It healed my soul very much. I felt healed by it, yeah. I felt very healed.
She belongs there, left with her liberty, never known as a non-believer. She laughs and stays in her world. Wondering who, wonderful you, I wonder it.